25, MS in KPOC and MCH in Scania again. And he has undergone training in Taiwan and Singapore for advanced microsurgery and hand surgery. And he's a senior consultant in the Department of Plastic and Reconstructive Surgery in Apollo Hospitals. His main areas of interest are in burns, hand injuries, diabetic foot, and trauma care. He has presented many national and international papers and has authored a book of chapter on brachial plexus injuries. Over to you, sir.
Thank you for the introduction, and thanks for inviting me to lecture on this for this audience. I'm going to give you a broad overview about surgical management of diabetic problems. I'm not going to go into the medical aspects at all, but I think most of you may be experts in management of medical problems. Now, my talk will be largely under these various headings, and let me quickly go through them. As far as epidemiology is concerned, I think all of you are knowing that diabetes is one of the biggest non-communicable diseases that is going to be affecting, or is already affecting the country. And possibly, you know, there have been reports that we'll possibly be the captains of diabetes very soon. Now, in that scenario, I think obviously the problems of diabetes and their complications are also on the rise. And if you possibly look at the last part of the slide, I think that is what is more disturbing, where seen that almost about 15% tend to develop foot ulcers, 14 to 15% will develop amputations, one leg being lost almost every 30 seconds, and then once an amputation, the risk of another amputation is much higher. And I think what should possibly be, what we should be concentrating is the last part, that most of these are potentially preventing problems. So that is where I think we should possibly be concentrating on, trying to see if we can try and prevent these problems rather than handle a very large issue. The challenges that we face are, one, most often patients tend to deny that they have a diabetic foot problem, in the sense that they don't have a peripheral neuropathy at all. Even if they come with you, or come to you with an ulcer, and then you try to tell them that possibly there is a neuropathy, most often they tend to deny. They think that it's perfectly normal. Maintaining target glucose levels is again a problem. Many of them are non-compliant with their medications and they will have fluctuating levels. Implementing lifestyle changes, again, very difficult for many people unless they are motivated. Many of them do not follow any lifestyle changes. Availability of treatment and follow-up, again, you need to have the right, proper, accurate treatment being given to them and the necessary follow-up. Again, the follow-up is, again, as you say, as we all know, is a very big problem. Most of the patients tend to be lost to follow-up. Once possibly the wound heals, or once possibly their symptoms are better, they just disappear from your radar. And then, of course, patient education and patient empowerment is again a big problem for our community. The risk factors that we are facing are poor glycemic control, peripheral neuropathy, as we all know, that's the main cause of this problem, associated sometimes with the peripheral vascular disease. And both these tend to develop foot deformities. And if they have a past history of an ulcer or a past history amputation, and in association with visual impairment, diabetic nephropathy, and the cigarette smoking, which is again quite common, all these are problems that we face when handling a patient with a diabetic foot ulcer. Etiopathogenesis, as I think most of us will know, that the neuropathy is possibly the main cause for it, and that causes deformity, then repeated trauma, and then ulceration. Basically, have a primary etiology as well as a secondary etiology. The primary etiology, as I said, it's a neuropathy, of course, the various segments of neuropathy, and then, of course, the secondary etiology of deformity, infection, peripheral vascular disease, etc. Now, this I don't think we need to discuss much about this. I think most of you would know that once you have a sensory neuropathy, obviously a sensory loss, patients tend to possibly develop ulcers or wounds which they don't recognize, goes unrecognized for a long period. When there is a motor neuropathy, there is some amount of muscle atrophy, there are biomechanics change, deformity of the foot happens, gait changes, that also makes these people prone for these ulcers. And then autonomic neuropathy, causing loss of sweating or autonomic disturbances happening, they develop dry skins and fissuring and ulceration, and all these together cause a problem of the ulcer. Basically, there are three types of ulcers that we see. One primarily is the neuropathic diabetic ulcer. That forms a fairly big chunk of about 35%. And then you have the other spectrum of being only ischemic ulcers, which are not so common. And then, of course, you have a common pathology where both neuropathy as well as the ischemic problem happening. And that forms, again, about 50% of the load that we see. We sometimes tend to categorize them as per the risk. Obviously, if they don't have any of these problems, the category is zero, but once they have an ulcer and the pulse is almost absent there, the risk is quite high. There are a lot of classifications which are there. I mean, no, maybe for academic purposes, you could possibly call them as grade 1, grade 2, stage 1, stage 2, whatnot. Ultimately, it is the management that is going to matter. And these stagings, to some extent, help you in stratifying your strategy for treatment. The management of these is a big teamwork. It is never a single man's job. An entire list of specialties are required, and these people together have to possibly manage it. So very often it is not that as a surgeon I possibly just treat the ulcer and possibly try to heal him, everything is over. Obviously a whole team of work is involved. Basic guidelines, what are we looking at? We need to have glycemic control and also the treatment of other comorbidities, which is quite obvious. Wound care, again, the wound per se, if it is going to be a conservative management, if they are small wounds, yes, they can possibly manage conservatively, whereas if you just have a moist bed, you should be able to absorb the X-ray that is coming out, treat the infection. Antimicrobial therapy, if there is an infection, obviously in that ulcer. Vascular intervention, if there is a peripheral vascular disease, has to be addressed, because unless you address that, most of the wounds will not possibly heal. Surgical wound closure, of course, that is what I'm going to talk to you a little more about. And offloading, basically taking off pressure. That again is something to be overemphasized, because most often, as I said, these people have biomechanics which have changed, they have altered shapes of their feet, their gait is totally different. And they need to possibly have some amount of offloading so that they can possibly prevent the recurrence of these ulcers once they have healed. Now, coming to wound care per se, we see a wide gamut of ulcers in these diabetic patients. Now, if you were to possibly manage them only conservatively, as I said, which could be possibly assigned only to a small group of patients, there are a number of medications or dressing methods which are available, which are flooded with materials. You could use any of them. Of course, they have several indications based on what the type of bed is, the amount of discharge, or what is the surrounding skin, etc., etc. But otherwise, basically, if you were to treat them non-surgically, you could possibly do it with a number of medications and dressing materials that are available. When we come to the surgical management, this is something we need to emphasize, basically, and then right. Now, most often, majority of the patients that come to us find that the debridement has been grossly inadequate. And that's why I'm going to call it as a radical debridement. It should be almost like a malignancy or like an oncological debridement that needs to be addressed in these patients. It is very, very difficult if you were to just possibly do a local debridement, which is what most often that surgeons or physicians, whoever are possibly treating them, are possibly a little scared to possibly debride more, because I think possibly they feel that they would end up in a bigger wound and have a bigger problem on their hands, not able to cover them. So the debridement is mostly suboptimal. And that is where most of the problems happen, because unless you do this quite radically on day one, or possibly the first time that you see it, you're going to have possibly bigger problems, ending up with much more major problem on your hand. So as you see possibly in this, if you were to possibly see these small patches of necrotic skin or slough, there's no point in just debriding these small areas alone. Ultimately, this is what the wound is going to end up like. So unless you possibly debride this, you are, once you feel, if you just take off these small patches of skin, you'll find there's going to be a lot of slough and pus inside, tunneling into various pockets, long tendons, long natural crevices, and that all needs to be opened up. So ultimately, you may end up in a much, much bigger wound, and you must be prepared for facing such a wound, and the patient should also, again, be warned that it is not going to be such a small problem, and it's going to be a much, much bigger problem. Similarly, if you were to possibly see a wound like this, which is obviously an ischemic neuropathic foot, that you obviously are seeing that the joint there is exposed, there is already an ischemic change is there, it's dead there. There's no point in buying and saving this stone. Very often, obviously, patients never want anything to be amputated, even if it's going to be a simple or small part of the toe. We always want to have it. But then, it's our duty to possibly tell them that if we possibly are going to try and keep this foot on, try to possibly do a little bit of minimal debridement, it's possibly going to end up in a bigger problem. So it needs to go, we need to possibly remove that entire toe, possibly part of the metatarsal, and then you may be able to cover the wound much faster and heal the wound much faster. Similarly, if you were to possibly see a wound something like this, there's going to be a lot of bone and joint exposed there, all the tendonitis is exposed there, all that has to go. There's no point. Very often we find a patient coming to us with the dorsum of the foot or dorsum of the hand where all the tendons are exposed. So only the skin has been removed, this the tendon is already exposed, it's already desiccating or drying. You possibly feel that if by keeping those tendons, you're possibly going to save function of them. No. Maybe it's going to end up with a bigger problem, and instead of possibly just losing a little bit of function, you may possibly lose the hand. So please be very liberal in your debridement. Go ahead and remove everything that looks dead. Some people tend to do this debridement under tourniquet control, but I prefer to do it without a tourniquet so that I know what is living, what is dead, so that I can possibly remove everything that is dead. Again, if it is a wound something like this, where you find that there's already a gangrene of the toe, there is an ischemic problem there, and there's another wound on the median malleolar region, we also have something on the lateral malleolar region, there's no point trying to salvage these feet. As I said, most often, yes, patients do want their parts to be salvaged, and you as a surgeon or a physician also want to possibly try and satisfy the patient and try to salvage them. Good. But then at some point, we should know, we should be able to draw the line. We should know what is possible and what is not possible. If you feel that this is something which is not possible to salvage, please go ahead and tell them that yes, it's not possible, and they may end up, in fact, this patient ended up with a pneumonia amputation. That's what needs to be done. In our country, especially in patients, mandates are quite important. Most of them are breadwinners. If you were to ask me, keep treating this conservatively with dressings, you go on for months and months together. So much of money that is going to be lost, traveling up and down to the clinic or hospital, the amount of dressing material, the amount of medications, the amount of visits to the doctors, fees, etc. If you were to take all that into account, if you possibly just did a below knee amputation and fitted it with the fantastic processes which are available nowadays, he's possibly back to work within maybe about 2 to 3 weeks' time. So ultimately, we should also look at that and not just try to see that, yes, I want to satisfy the patient with this same thing. So that's why I'm going to concentrate or possibly I'm going to emphasize on this point that a debridement has to be a very, very radical debridement. Now, once you've debrided it, obviously, yes, you're going to end up with a big wound and you need your skin cover. These are basically what we call as a reconstructive bladder. They start off with possibly a primary suture, which is hardly possible in most of these patients. Most often they tend to require some form of a skin cover, which could be either a skin flap or what we call a skin flap. Those of you who are not very well versed with these terms, a skin graft is where we are using just a thin layer of skin, which is only the epidermis and part of the dermis. When we talk about flaps, we are talking about thicker layers of skin, which includes the entire thickness of the skin, maybe also the subcutaneous fat, fascia, muscle, whatever is it. Whenever you want a much healthier or stable skin cover. So what is the type of skin cover that you're going to get? Now if you have a healthy wound, okay, now when I say a healthy wound, what do I mean? There should be no infection, which means that the wound is covered with good granulation. There's no exposure of bare bones or tendons. There's no exposure of any joints there. And there's no exposure of any vital structures. Now if none of these are there, I think skin graft is possibly the ideal cover. So this is what possibly I would love to see if I have possibly a wound like this which has been prepared well and it's got a good granulation, it's an ideal wound to be covered with the skin graft. So most often skin grafts will give you a fairly well settled wound and a stable skin graft. But sometimes you need to prepare them and they may not be ready. Of course, as I said, either you do some of these dressings to get them ready or sometimes nowadays we use what is called as a vacuum or suction assisted closure. It's a device which tends to, you know, suck out the wound and tries to get the wound ready much faster. So once you do that, you can possibly cover them much earlier. There are also a lot of newer dressing materials. Silver ion is something which is very popular in the market. You do something like that, and then possibly get the wound ready and cover it with a skin. Now, what if you can't use a skin graft? Now, if the wound is unfit for a skin graft, which means there's exposure of bare bone joints, the wound is over a subcutaneous bone, or in the area subject to pressure or friction, which is most often, let's say, between the sole, you would possibly think in terms of flap B as a choice. Now, when we talk about flaps, there are various categories or various types of flaps that we use. Most often, we tend to use what's called the local flap. When we say a local flap, basically means we are just using tissue very close or adjacent to the wound. The advantages are it provides the same quality of skin. Most often it is sensitive. Of course, if there is a neuropathy, that may not be so sensitive. But there's very minimal donor site morbidity. Now I'll go through some of the types of local skin flaps that we use. There's something known as a VY advancement. Diagrammatically, this is what it is. We use a flap which is in a V shape, then advance it to cover the defect and then close the wound as a Y. So that's a trophic ulcer which is on the sole. You used a flap, advanced it, and then closed it like a Y. This is again a similar trophic ulcer on the foot. You can possibly use a flap from the same foot, advanced it, and closed it like a Y. Some of the other types of local flaps are what are called rotation flaps, where you have something on the weight bearing heel to protect the skin from the entire foot, and then use it to cover the foot. This is again a type of rotation flap, now moved from the lateral side of the foot. These are what are known as transposition flaps, wherein you just again, there's a bunion excise, there's an ulcer there, you use the skin flap from there, put it in, cover the wound, and then that residual wound the skin graft off. This one is an instep of iron flap. You use a flap from the inner aspect of the foot, which is generally a non-weight bearing area, so you can safely use it. Use that, which is actually based on what is called as a median plantar artery of the foot, and then use to cover the heel defect. These are sometimes when you have wounds over the lateral calcaneum, which is again a bunion which has been excised, you could use what is known as a lateral calcaneal artery flap. Sometimes on the heel, you could use some of the local muscles which are available. This is the upper digiti condyle, which is on the lateral side. Sometimes similarly, you could use the upper hallucis, which is on the medial side, which is the common. Now once, let's say you are not able to get a local flap for whatever reason, so you could use what are known as regional flap. When you say regional, it means from the same area, not adjacent to the bone. For example, if it's on the foot, it's on the leg. So if a local flap is not available, we use skin flaps from the same leg, which is basically something known as an identified perforator or bone vessels. Most often, they are what are known as distally based. That means the wound is somewhere in the lower part, whereas we are getting the skin from the upper part, so the blood circulation actually comes more distant. And very often, they are safe if you are able to technically institute it. For example, this is a wound on the dorsum of the foot. You use what is known as a lateral perforator, the lateral peroneal vessels. So that's the flap which is coming there. Then it covers the defect, and finally you could divide this and separate it after 3 weeks or so. Similarly, if you had something on the heel, you could use a flap from the calf region, pull it down, and cover that ulcer there. If again, for some reason, you're not able to get a regional flap also, you could use what is known as a distant or a free flap. These are flaps which are got from totally different areas. Most often, we tend to use it by what is known as a microsurgical procedure, where we use a tissue from somewhere else, let's say from the chest or from the abdomen, detach the tissue along with the blood circulation, bring it to the foot, and reattach or revascularize it by connecting it to the vessel. Now, earlier people used to think that they were contraindicated in diabetic foots because basically, an angiopathy is there or the circulation is not so good. But most often, you find that it is a micro vessel which are damaged. Most often, if you do a Doppler, you find that the bigger vessels are normal. So, you could still possibly go ahead and run. So, these are distant flaps. Sometimes, as I said, you use it as a microvascular flap. That's a microvascular flap. That's another flap. But you could also use what are known as cross-leg flaps. These are nowadays quite outdated. The advent of microvascular flaps, we normally don't use these distant flaps anymore. The post-op care is very, very important. You should get a good tension-free closure of whatever skin cover you're giving, a good and appropriate dressing, point the pressure to the operated area, immobilize them and elevate these limbs, and have regular dressings. And the leg post-op is also equally important. Foot care, as I said, is very, very important. We need to teach these patients how to take care of their feet, cleanliness, massage to the operated areas, compression stockings sometimes if they have edematous limbs, and proper footprint. offloading, as I said, is very, very important. Once you have possibly treated these ulcers and they heal, you need to possibly give them proper footwear so that the pressure is taken off from that area. Various types of such footwear are available. They are mostly custom made for the patient. So if you are going to talk about skin graft or flap, as I said, generally skin grafts are preferable and they are acceptable for non-pressure bearing areas, whereas flaps are ideal for possibly the pressure bearing areas. However, this is generally not a very definite term. Very often we have used skin grafts on the sole toe. So summarizing, as far as the wound care is concerned, radical debridement, please don't hesitate to amputate if you feel that it is not a salvage but for prepare the wound early so that you can give an early skin cover and a good post-op care. Prevention is again something very, very important. We need to take care of all these factors. We need to educate these patients well, teach them proper foot care, teach them about wearing the footwear both inside the house as well as outside. That's again something very important. Most of us are, it's like a taboo wearing footwear inside the house, but these patients should be told that irrespective of whether it's inside or outside, they need to wear proper footwear. So summarizing, it's a multi-specialty teamwork. Proper glycemic control doesn't need to be emphasized at all. Antimicrobial therapy if it's required. Vascular surgery, again, if there's a vascular problem. Debride the wounds with early skin cover, offload them, and give them a good lifestyle modification and education. Thank you.
Any questions, sir? Patients who have small ulcers who don't want to undergo surgery, if there is not good granulation, there is a role for platelet-rich plasma therapy into the local wound, and we've had excellent results where there is good granulation where we can give back the patient again. So ulcers not
like somebody said about stem cells, PRP is not evidence-based yet. It's been extensively used for all sorts of disorders, even for wounds. I know people have got good results. I don't think there's any still different evidence based on that.
Yeah. That's our experience that patients who don't want to undergo first surgery, there is something to offer and we have had grant from the
nurse.
Yes. How good is Oxum solution going to you?
Oxum, I used to use it earlier. It's basically a sort of a cleansing agent. I would say it is something which does magic to the wound. But yes, it can be used. It's a sort of a peroxide-based solution. It does do a little bit of cleansing of the wounds. As I said, the market is now flooded with a lot of these topics altogether of what this is not what particular wound. But yes, there are a lot of such dressing materials available. If it works with your hands, please.
At what point of time do you see the
vascular
system in
doubt before
you undertake? At what point of time do you investigate the vascular system before you undertake surgery?
In fact, almost all these patients do have an initial Doppler study. Now, if the Doppler is doubtful or does show some amount of, you know, different basic flow, we always possibly put them on to the vascular surgeon. We possibly do an angiogram. If it possibly requires some sort of revascularization or possibly some amount of augmentation, that needs to be addressed first. I think there's no point if there is a vascular compromise, there's no point in trying to heal that wound without augmenting the wound sufficiently. It's almost done as a workup initially. Yes.
Hyperbaric oxygen
again has got limited role in these patients. It's usually a very long-term therapy. Some wounds do get better, but it's basically an everyday sitting for, you know, possibly weeks or months together sometimes. It depends on the type of the wound. But if you are proving that, yes, the tissue oxidation there, that's a prerequisite for that. If you prove that the tissue oxidation is less in that area, yes, possibly it's going to help. But then if the tissue oxidation is less, it possibly also requires a vascular workup, and if you can possibly augment it that way, possibly much better or faster in healing the wounds.
Have you recommended your patients for hyperbaric oxygen?
No. I don't believe in it. I don't.
Okay.
Thank you. Now I request Dr. Mani, our president, last question to And a reservative appreciation to you.